They say examination of a patient with pustular skin lesions allowed to isolate a causative agent that forms in the blood agar, runnish yellow middle-sized colonies surrounded by hemolysin zone. Smears from the colonies contain irregular shaped clusters of gram-positive cocci. The culture is oxidase and catalase positive. It ferments mannitol and synthesizes plasmocoagulase. What causative agent are they talking about? From the all indications, they are definitely talking about what? Staphylococcus. They are talking about Staphylococcus aureus. Staphylococcus aureus. Why? Because Staphylococcus aureus is a gram-positive round-shaped bacteria. Round-shaped bacterium. Let me put it that way. Round-shaped what? Bacterium. And again, somebody is joining. And again, what do? They have, it's often positive for catalase and then nitrate reduction. Nitrate reduction. Almost everything that has been said in this question is pointing towards what? Staphylococcus. And again, we don't teach this thing. Okay. You must know it. We don't teach it. Or we don't, I don't know how to put it, but basically, you have to know that this is what Staphylococcus. Unfortunately, you have to know. But like I said, the key word is that these can, the oxidase and then the catalase are all what? Positive. They're all positive. And again, too, they show positive plasmocoagulase. So all of these things are all pointing towards what? Staphylococcus aureus. Staphylococcus aureus. And sometimes, too, they appear as a grape. So grape-like clusters. Grape. Some of you eat grapes. So grape-like clusters. All of these things are all what? Staphylococcus. Staphylococcus. All right. So your answer is what? Is C, Staphylococcus aureus. Microscopic examination of a gram stain scrape from the patient's tank revealed oval, round, elongated chains of dark violet germinating cells. What disease are we looking at? Look at it. The fact that they brought these germinating cells there should tell you that they are talking about what? About a fungi infection. So this is what a fungal infection. And there are two main types of fungal infection. We have the yeast and then what? Molds. We have yeast and then molds. Now, yeast grow as a single cells that reproduce by gametin. They reproduce by what? Gametin. They reproduce by what? Gametin. Molds, on the other hand, they grow by means of hyphae. Or hyphae. They grow by means of what? Hyphae and then mycelium. Mycelium. No, it is M-Y-C-E. Mycelium. M-Y-C-E-L-I-U-M. So this is how what they grow. So basically, this refers to what? How do you call it? A yeast infection. So basically, we are looking at what? A candida. Candida albicans is a yeast infection. Candida albicans or candidosis is a yeast infection. It is a yeast infection. And it can occur in the respiratory system, it can occur in the GIT, and even the female genital tract. It can occur there. Candida. And usually, they, when they come to the clinic, in terms of genital, they will say they have white. So if you hear of white, they are referring to what? A candida infection or candidosis or candidiasis. They are all the same. From pharynx of a child, there were suspicion of what? Diphtheria. A pure culture of the microorganism was isolated. Their microscopical, tentorial, cultural, and biochemical properties appeared to be typical for diphtheria causative word agent. What studies should be conducted in order to draw a conclusion that this is a pathogenic diphtheria bacillus? A pathogenic diphtheria bacillus. So, you remember when we were talking about the test that you have to do for diphtheria or conibacterial diphtheria. And we're talking about phage conversion. You remember? Phage conversion. You remember it? I think the beginning of the lesson. Phage conversion. And you said you are more or less like turning a non-harmful or a non-toxic to a toxic. Okay. What it means is that you are trying to estimate the toxicity of the bacteria, the toxigenic property of the bacteria, or the toxigenicity. So here you are looking at what? The toxigenetic properties. Toxigenic properties. Again, this is what? Phage conversion. The test is called phage conversion. Phage conversion. And I believe you remember it. All right. But you see how they've put it in a different way in this question. Okay? So the answer is what? It's B. Again, look at this. Examination of a child reveal whitish spots. White, looking like a coagulated milk on the mucous membrane of his cheeks and tongue. Analysis reveal what? Gram-positive over yeast cells. What is the most common over yeast cell that can affect the mouth? You are thinking of what? A candida. We have already answered this. It's a candida. Candida. So if you understand these things, easy to answer your questions. So you say, oh, candida. Over yeast. Okay. A duodenal content smear of a patient with indigestion contains a protozoa of this size. It has piriform bodies, four pairs of filament, two symmetrically located nuclei in the broadened part of the body. What kind of the lowest organism is it? And over here, you are looking at a paired shape microorganism, also known as what? Giardia lamblia. Giardia lamblia. Yeah. And this is a pear shaped with two nuclei, four pairs of what? Flagella. Four pairs of flagella. So again, the clue here is what? Therefore, there's what? Four pairs of flagella and then two what? Nuclei. Two nuclei. So here is what? Lamblia. And if you see the structure itself, you appreciate it. Very, very colorful. All right, so this is what? E. The blood of a patient with presumable sepsis was inoculated into a sugar broth. There appeared bottom sediment. Repeated inoculation into the blood agar caused growth of small transparent round colonies surrounded by hemolysis zone. Guys, do you remember when we were talking about the characteristics of the staff and stuff? So this is what? The opposite form of it. So look at it. Look at the striking one. Examination of the smear from the sediment revealed a gram coca in the form of long chains. If they are said in the form of grapes or grape-like, then you could think of what? Of staphylococcus. But these are long chains. So long chains, you are thinking of what? Streptococcus. So here, you are looking at what? Streptococcus. All right. On a bacteriological examination of the defecation of a 4-month-old baby with symptoms of acute bowel infection, they revealed red colonies spread in the large intestine in endo environment. What microorganism are they referring to? Guys, again, you remember when I was talking about endo agar and then the EMB agar? Yes. I said both Endo agar and then the EMB agar, also known as eosin methylene blue agar. They are very, very specific stains for gram-negative what? Bacteria. For gram-negative what? Bacteria. And they help us to distinguish between what? A fermented lactose. An example is what? The E. coli. Then the ones that do not ferment. Example is what? Salmonella. Salmonella. And in our previous question, we saw a colorless or achromic microorganism. Achromic. That means colorless. Colorless. But this one, there is color. Red colonies. So what comes to mind? It's two things that you are thinking of. Either E. coli or Salmonella. With E. coli, you would think of what? Color being present because it undergoes what? Fermentation. It undergoes what? Fermentation. So you can't say it is colorless. No, 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 no. It has a color. So here you are going for it for E. coli, also known as Escherichia. E. coli, E. coli, E. coli. Again, if you understand this concept, you enjoy it. So write it down again. Endo environment. Endo environment or endo agar. Endo agar or EMB. Eosin methylene blue. Eosin methylene blue agar. Write it down. Write it down, please. Again, Salmonella will be what? Colorless. E. coli will be what? Will be colorful. So the answer is what? A. Great. Guys, look at this again. Understand concept. Understand the concept. Look at it. Bacteriological examination of a patient with food poisoning required inoculation of a pure culture. Gram-negative movable bacilli in endo medium. So if they mention endo medium, two organisms come to mind, either Salmonella or E. coli. How do you differentiate between them? One is colorless, one is colorful. So look at this. They said in an endo medium in the form of colorless. Your answer is what? Thank you. Salmonella. Salmonella. No need for me to waste my time again. So you got Salmonella. So let's go. Examination of a young man in A center produced a positive result of immune enzyme what? ACE with HIV antigens. Patients complained about the state of his health were absent. What can the positive result of immune ACE be evidence of? Again, positive result of it means that there is a presence of HIV what? Antigens. It means there's a presence of what? HIV what? Antigens. And if HIV antigens are present, it means that this person is having what? HIV infection. So please, no need to waste your time. This person is what? Having HIV infection. Your answer is D. Is D. Aha. Guys, again, look at this. Staining of what? Zeonosin. Zeonosin is for what? Yes, it is for what? Bacteria. And I'm saying that, what do they do for? This is for the acid resistance what? Test. I mentioned it. Acid resistance what? Test. Or acid fast test. All of this is all mean what? Zeonosin what? Staining. And it's for what? Tuberculosis. This is for what? Tuberculosis. Look. What property of tuberculosis bacilli was shown? Acid resistance. Acid resistance. Acid resistance. So please, don't confuse yourself. This is D. This is D. Again, if you understand the concept, no need to worry. No need to worry. Reaction of a passive hemagglutination conducted with erythrocytic typhoid V1 diagnosticum helped to reveal some antibodies in the dilution of the patient's serum at a ratio of 1:80 that exceeds the diagnostic titer. It exceeds the diagnostic titer. What such result witnesses of what? It means that if you have serum of 1:80 that exceeds the diagnostic titer, what does it mean? What does it mean? If for you, I'll write this down. So when the dilution of the patient's serum, okay, is more than the diagnostic titer, it means that the patient is a potential carrier for the infectious agent. It means the patient is a potential what? Carrier of the infectious what? Agent. Now, If it is less than the diagnostic titer, the examination is carried out again in 10 to 14 days after the first examination. I repeat, when the diagnostic titer is less. Sorry, when the serum distance is less, ratio is less than the titer, you have to conduct it again in 10 to 14 days after the first one. Please, you have to conduct it again. And why? Because you want to be sure that there is no infection there. You want to be sure that there is no infection there. However, a dilution of the patient's serum that gives the diagnostic titer indicate acute or chronic infection. Aha. So I've explained three things. One, if it is more than that, is the dilution is more than the diagnostic titer. You are thinking of a potential carrier. If it is less, it means it is not there. But to be sure, you have to conduct the test again in 10 to 14 days time. Then if it is the same or it gives you the diagnostic titer, it means that this person is having an acute or a current infection. Acute or current infection. So over here, since it is more than the titer, it means this person is a carrier or a potential carrier. So it's been a potential carrier for the typhoid bacilli. So your answer is D. All right. In order to determine toxigenicity of a diphtheria bacilli, again, you are thinking of phage conversion. A strip of filter paper impregnated with antitoxic diphtheria serum was put on the dense nutrient medium. There were also inoculated a microbial culture under examination and a strain that is known to be toxigenic. If the microbial culture under examination produces exotoxin, this will result in the formation of what? So again, if it produces exotoxin, it definitely will confirm that there is a diphtheria, isn't it? Based on what we have discussed so far. But how would the result be shown? How would the result be shown? That's what the question is talking about. So the result will show what we call a precipitin line. Precipitin line. That is what will show. A precipitin line. Can you hear me, guys?
I can hear
myself. Yes, sir.
I can't seem to hear myself. That's why. Sorry. So we're looking at So if you do the phage conversion and there is exotoxic or there is toxin being produced, they show as a precipitin lines. Precipitin lines. They show as a precipitin lines. And a precipitin line is simply an antibody which can precipitate out of a solution upon antigen binding. So because there's an antibody has been bound with this toxic substance, it begins to show those lines. It begins to show those lines. And that's what we call it, a precipitin lines. It's a microbiology. I don't know how to show it, but they produce a precipitin lines. So here, your answer should be Should be precipitin line. That is C. Precipitin lines. All right. And again, let me add this one to it. When a filter paper, is used, precipitin lines are produced. And a precipitin ring is produced when tubes are used. If you use tubes, you produce precipitin ring. If you use a paper, like in this case, a filter paper, a strip of filter paper, you produce a precipitin lines. So get a difference. So this means paper? P-A-P-R. P-E-R. This one means A tube. Tube. So please don't mix the two. So your answer is C. All right. A 50-year-old patient with typhoid fever was treated with levomycetin. Okay. You can treat it with it too. Or Cipro. You can treat it with them. Now the next day, his condition became worse. Temperature is 39.6. What caused the worsening? What caused the worsening? And again, don't forget that these substances produce what they call toxins, okay? They produce toxins. So if this drug is not working properly on this bacteria or this salmonella, that means that it is the effect of the endotoxin of this typhoid or the salmonella that is causing the rise in temperature, and hence the parent becoming what? Worse. The parent becoming what? Worse. So again, it means that, you know, I was telling you that typhoid has resistance, okay? They have resistance. So if you give a drug and it's not working, like I said earlier on, people go and come back that they're still, condition is there or even is even getting worse. It means that the drug is not working. The microorganisms are resistant to this medication. So what do? You do a culture. You will do a culture. And this culture will tell you which drug will be sensitive to this microorganism or this agent. Great, great. So here we are thinking of what? The effect of endotoxin agent. The effect of the endotoxin agent. So your answer is A. Another diphtheria question again. They say, in order to estimate toxicity of a diphtheria, again, what comes to mind? Phage conversion. Great. Obtained from the patient, the culture was inoculated on a petri dish with nutrient agar on the side of the paper strip. So if it's a paper strip, what will you see? Precipitating what? Lines. Precipitating what? Lines. Great. Great. That was put into the center and moistened with anti-diphtheric antitoxin serum. After incubation of inoculation in agar, the strip-like areas of the medium turbidity were found between separate cultures and the strip filter paper. What immunological reaction was conducted? Again, I've told you that you're going to see what? A precipitating line. That means you're doing what? A precipitation reaction. So basically, that's what it means. So please, don't think too much about all of these things. Just know that because you're going to look for the presence of these lines, definitely, by all means, a reaction was there, or a precipitation reaction was there. And I told you that this reaction is simply what? When the antibody reacts with the what? The antigen or the toxic that have now been produced. That is just it. Through the phage conversion. So here you are looking at what? A precipitation gel reaction. Precipitation what? Gel reaction. Don't go and say rings of precipitating reaction. No. Don't forget, in paper, it doesn't give you rings. It gives you what? Lines. It gives you lines. Lines, please. Bikonu. It gives you what? Lines. All right. So let's continue. Oh, this person has already given us the answer. Aha. Guys, look at this. A patient with clinical signs of encephalitis was delivered to the infectious disease. Analysis registered a tick bite. There was a reaction, helped to review the antibodies. Look at this. The encephalitis has a dilution title of what? 1:20, which is not diagnostic. Not diagnostic, meaning it is below. It is below. And I say if it is below, you do what? You have to repeat the examination. How many days time? 10 to 14 days. 10 to 14 days. I mentioned this one earlier on. You do test 10 to 14 days. Now, if it is diagnostic, it means this person is what is infected. Then if it's above or it exceeds the diagnostic, it means what? A carrier. Thank you. So your answer is what? It's B. To repeat examination with a serum taken 10 days after. 10 days to 14, actually. You see, everything is making sense. So don't confuse yourself in any way. The first grade people were examined in order to sort out children for tuberculosis revaccination. What test? Guys, tuberculosis, you do what? Mantoux test. Tuberculosis, you do what? Mantoux test. Please. So the answer is what is A? Mantoux test. clinical diagnosis of a female patient was gonorrhea. What examination method can be applied to confirm this? How do you confirm gonorrhea? Don't forget, we have to do a microscopic examination. You have to do a microscopic examination. And under the microscope, what you will see? You will see a gram, you stain it, and then you will see gram-negative bean-shaped diplococci, right? Exactly. So here you do microscopy. However, PCR is becoming more common. PCR, that's polymerase chain reaction. This is becoming more common. Of course, it's not in the question, but I'm just saying it's in practical or in the real world. Okay, in the real world. We have what we call PCR, becoming more common. All right, so answer is A. What do we have? Patient is suffering from periodical attacks caused by inhalation of different flavoring substances. Guys, look, atopic bronchial asthma. And I've mentioned it over here. Atopic means what? It means anaphylaxis. It means ranging. It means immediate type of hypersensitivity. It means type 1 hypersensitivity. Good. Look at it. They say IgE level was increased. What is it typical for? Again, anaphylactic reaction. Your answer is D. I think I'm beginning to love microbiology. Your answer is what? Is D. And please, we have discussed all of these things in our previous presentations. So do go to watch the video. If you are new, watch the video. Otherwise, some of these things, you might think is new, but it's not new. Most of us, I believe, we understand it. That's why I'm just going to doing it proper patterns. All right. Guy. The same question. Suffering from periodic attacks. The same question. Atopic. So it's the same question. So the answer is what? Is D. The answer is D. All right. Good. Now, researchers of a biological laboratory examined thin meat. For botulinic toxin. For this purpose, a group of mice were injected with an extract of the bacteria, under examination and botulinic serum of A, B, and E types. A control group of mice was injected with the same extract, but without the anti-botulinic serum. What surgical reaction was applied? And over here, we could be looking at for neutralization reaction. So first of all, what is a serological reaction or a serological test? A serological test is simply a test that is used to determine the presence of antibodies in the blood serum. I repeat, it is used to determine the presence of antibodies in a blood serum. In neutralization reaction, the presence of antibodies are able to neutralize the toxins produced by the organism. I repeat, in neutralization, it means the antibodies react with the antigens or neutralizes with the antigens produced by the infectious organisms. And so therefore, a positive test will mean that the patient is infected. It means the patient is infected. And this is very, very specific for botulism. It's very, very specific for botulism. Yeah,
with the color combination to be mad.
Wait, see, your microphone is on. So kindly mute it for us. Well, you see, your mic is on. Okay. All right.
Bye.
Can someone call where is Ogla? Ogla, message him that his microphone is on. I think he's somewhere. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. All right. So basically, we are referring to what? A neutralization reaction in this particular what? Question. Why? Because we are trying to see if this the research we are going to, if these mice will be able to produce or neutralize the antigen whatsoever. Okay. So that's what happens. So we are using the method of what? Neutralization. We are using the method of what? Neutralization. Neutralization. So here we are thinking of what? Of D, neutralization reaction. Neutralization reaction. All right. What do we have? We say for the purpose of retrospective diagnostic of recent bacteria dysentery.
Something
Lord, your microphone is on. Lord, your microphone is on. Great. So, for the purpose of retrospective diagnostic of a recent bacterial dysentery, it was determined to perform a serological examination. And again, as I said, serological examination means what? Trying to produce what? Antibodies to react, right? Of the blood serum in order to determine, antibody titer towards shigellosis or Shiga bacilli. That means a Shigella. What of the following reaction should be applied? Look at it. We are talking about retrospective. We are talking about what? Retrospective. Retrospective. So in retrospective, we use what? Passive hemagglutination. Passive hemagglutination. Hemagglutination is simply what? The clamping together of red blood cells. Why would there be a clamping? This is because there's antibodies or the blood are not in or the presence of antibodies or RBCs absorb antigens and then antibodies will go and what attack it. So as a result, there will be a clamping or there will be agglutination. I believe you understand this agglutination thing. But we're talking about a retrospective what? Diagnosis. Retrospective. That means way back. Retrospective. So passive. 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 All right. So we're talking about passive hemagglutination reaction. Passive. 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 All right. During repeated without agglutination test, again, I said what test is used for? What is without test used for? Yes, it is used for what? Typhoid fever. I told you guys, without test is generally used for what? Typhoid fever. But after without test, it's not enough because you need to know the sensitivity of the antigen. That is the typhoid. You need to know the sensitivity. So you do what? A blood culture again. But it's not about blood culture. Let's look at it again. They said during repeated without agglutination tests, it was noticed that the ratio of antibody titers and O antigens, similar typhi in the patient serum, had increased from 100 to 1, from 1 is to 100 to 1 is to 400. How will you interpret this? How will you interpret this? Again, we have to go through some few things, which I'll briefly go through it with you about weather tests. Now, the weather test is positive if O antigen titer is more than 1 is to 160 in an active infection. You can write it down. Again, weather test is positive if O antigen or O antigen titer is more than 1 is to 160 in an active infection. Or if H antigen, we could also have H antigen. If H antigen is more than 1 is to what? 1 is to 160 in a past infection. passed, that means long-term infection. So I repeat, if whether test is positive, it means the O antigen, it has 1:1, the theta is 1:160 is more. If it is more, then we're having what? An active infection. And then if H antigen is more than 1:160, then we're having what? A past infection or an immunized person. That means he has been what? And he has undergone what? Immunization. He has undergone what? Immunization. Great. So therefore, what are we having here? We are having an increase from 1:100 to 1:400. 1:100 to 1:400. This is more. This is more. And this is an O antigen. So if it is more, what does it mean? It means that this patient has the typhoid fever. Because I said, if it's more than 1:160 for O antigen, then infection is there, or active infection is there. Then if it is H antigen, which is more than 1:160, it means there's no typhoid, but there was a past typhoid, and the person has developed what, an immunity against it. So if this one was H, then this would have been answered. The person was previously vaccinated against it. That is if it was H. But this is what O. So that means this person is having what? The typhoid. It's having the typhoid. So the answer is what? It's A. All right. A patient recovered from sonic dysentery and was once more infected. Look, you recovered from a disease and you get infected again with the same agent. What is it called? This phenomenon is called reinfection. This phenomenon is called reinfection. It's called reinfection. All right. Look at this. 10-year-old child, Mantox tuberculosis test was administered. Mantox. Mantox is what type of reaction? Guys, this is type 4. We have said it like 2 million times. 2 million times. Seriously. This is what type 4. Type 4. All right. And please, for those who just join us again, I give specific diseases for each and every hypersensitivity reaction. I remember in type 1, I gave. In type 2, I gave. In type 3, we gave. And in type 4, we gave. So please, if you've not watched the video, go. And if you've already watched it but you've forgotten, try and revise it. I beg you. Revise it. Revise it. All right. That was just by the way. We have a patient with clinical presentation of immunodeficiency. Anytime you see immune deficiency, it means which cells are you talking about? Of course, T lymphocyte. T lymphocyte comes to mind. They say when tumorological was examination, they revealed significant loss of cells that form rosettes with erythrocyte of a ram. What conclusion can be drawn? Again, immune deficiency. So what are you talking about? You are thinking of a decrease in T lymphocyte. Sorry. Sorry, I took Mortar Guinea, so I don't know. I'm feeling some gases around. So you are thinking of a decrease of T lymphocytes. Decrease of T lymphocyte. You see, if you understand this, eh? Chai, it a big keke. So the answer is A. As a result of durative antibiotic therapy, a 37-year-old patient developed intestinal dysbacteriosis. Guys, you remember, if you give too much of antibiotics for a very long time, what happened? Dysbacteriosis will happen. So what type of drug should be used in order to normalize the intestinal microflora? The intestinal microflora. And over here, what you need to give, we call it what? Eubiotics. 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 And this is the term used in feed industry where it refers to a healthy balance of microbiota or microflora. Microflora in the GIT tract. In the GIT tract. So your answer is what? Is B. All right. Don't worry, we'll go for break very soon. Among junior children of an orphanage, an outbreak of intestinal infection with signs of cholecystitis was registered. In order to identify a cytotoxic agent, it is necessary to, again, we're having what? Cholecystitis. So how will you what, find this causative what agent? How will you find this what causative what agent? So what you need to do is what? Is to study the antigenic what properties. Study the antigenic what properties of the organism. Study the antigenic what properties. And again, in cholecystitis, what is the antigenic structure? The antigen structure is what is 0111 or III. You remember this because we've answered a similar question like that. So this is what the antigenic structure of cholecystitis or cholecystitis, the antigenic what structure, antigenic structure. So here, determine it. This is what E. Study the antigenic structure of the causative agent. The causative agent. So the answer is E. Urine examination of a patient with acute cystitis revealed leukocyte and a lot of gram negative. Inoculation resulted in growth of colonies of mucous nature. Guys, green soluble pigment. I've said this before. Green soluble what? Pigment. You are either thinking of what? Of Pseudomonas or what? Salmonella. You are thinking of either what? Salmonella or Pseudomonas. Because they usually have what? This kind of green pigment. Now, what microorganism is most probable in this case? What microorganism is most probable in this case? Look, in Salmonella, you will be thinking of what? Of the GIT, basically. But this is taking place in the what? In the bladder. Or in the cyst. That's bladder. Urinary bladder, not cyst. Urinary bladder. But we call it what? Cystitis. If there's what? Inflammation of the bladder. It doesn't mean that it's a cyst. No. So this is what? Acute cystitis or inflammation of the urinary what? Bladder. So we'll go in for more with what? With Pseudomonas. We'll go in for Pseudomonas instead of what? Salmonella. So A should be our answer. A should be our answer. All right. A lab received a material from a patient's wound. Diagnosis was gaseous gangrene. Gaseous gangrene. What microbiological method should be applied to determine the causative agent? What should be applied to determine the causative what agent. So normally, we can deal with what? We have two main methods, okay? We have what we call bacteriological and then immunological. Bacteriological and then immunological. In bacteriological, an organism is identified by staining and culturing, whilst in immunological, an organism is identified by detection of antibodies. So please take note of the differences. In bacteriological, you are dealing with what? Staining and culture. Then in immunological, you are dealing with what? Detection of antibodies. Detection of what? Antibodies. Detection of antibodies. So over here, what are we going to do more? We are going to do what? Bacteriological. So your answer should be what? Should be D. Now, if they say bacterioscopic, it's more or less like using a microscope. Okay? It's more or less using a microscope. But the general term should be what? Of course, you can choose to use a microscope or other thing for bacteriological. Actually, the two of them should have moved hand in hand. But now, they are all what options. But the preferred one would be what? Bacteriological. All right. So the answer is what is D. What do we have? A virological laboratory lab obtained pathological material. They obtained pathological material. That's mucus discharge from the meatus. taken from a patient with provisional diagnosis of an influenza. What quick test will allow to reveal specific viral antigen? Specific viral antigen. And I remember we did something similar like this in one of the bases. And we said, usually, we do what we call what? Immunofluorescence. We do what we call what? Immunofluorescence. And this is a technique which is based on the use of what? A specific antibodies, which has been chemically conjugated to the fluorescent dyes, hence the name immunofluorescence. Immunofluorescence. And again, immuno because antibodies are being used, and fluorescent because this is conjugated to what? The fluorescent what? Dyes. It is connected to what? The fluorescent dye. But actually, the main method is what? It's immunological. So this is a form of what? Immunological. Immunological. And again, they provide a rapid and specific what? Diagnosis. Rapid and specific diagnosis. So here, we're going for what? A direct and indirect immunofluorescent test. Direct and indirect immunofluorescent test.